rocks keep falling. 6:16 in the morning. Hey, don't let your eyes keep falling. 6:16 in the morning. Don't you let your eyes. Don't you.
Seems like we are in very unsettling and uncertain times. But you know, for the believer, for those that are in Christ, everything's going to be all right.
Amen.
And the future of the people of God is sure. It's already been laid out in God's word. So when people are confused and when they're upset and they're panicking and don't know what to do, everything's going to be all right for the people of God. Can you say amen with me this morning? Is the church alive this morning? As judge in all three of these future judgments, that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth. God does not divide his bride. You don't divide God's church. Try to tell white Christians what they should be doing and black Christians what they should be doing. Do you know what Paul said about all that? Read Ephesians or Philippians chapter 3. This is the first thing that he said. I'm the Hebrew of Hebrews, the pure bread of Israel. You know what he was looking at? His own race and culture. You know what he says? All these things that I once counted as gain, now I count them all as loss. I count them all as loss. Notice, including his race and his culture. When you come to the cross of Jesus, you die to everything. That's why Jesus said you must deny yourself. Pick up your cross and follow me. I have denied every part of me other than what Jesus says who I am. And I am his child, and that's it.
Thank you so much for clicking on for this Come to Church with Me video. And as usual, if you guys know the drill around here, whenever I do a Come to Church with Me, I always go over my notes with you guys. If you could not tell, this past Sunday's sermon was fire. It was great. It was amazing. And it's not a message that you hear preached in a lot of churches in America today. So I'm really excited to go over these notes with you guys. Just a disclaimer, I am not a preacher person, I'm not a pastor, and I'm not going to attempt to try to preach this message the way my pastor did. I am just going to do my best to go over my notes with you guys in some level of understanding and kind of connect it to my quiet time that morning. If you could not tell, it is not the same day. I actually recorded this on that day, but the audio came out really weird and I was just really flustered that day, so I just scrapped the whole thing and I'm gonna do this over again for you guys. So it's actually Tuesday today and I have my notes right here and we are just gonna get right into it. These are my notes for this past Sunday. I had a blue theme going. I usually choose a color theme and go with that. This past Sunday, my pastor was talking about, and by the way, in case you're curious, that's not my every Sunday pastor. He's the pastor of the youth group at our church and he was preaching this Sunday. He was preaching on judgment, and this is not your everyday worldly celebrity popular gospel teaching on judgment. This is not what that was. This was a real biblical revelation book of the Bible teaching on judgment. And it was so powerful and it was so timely, especially with the times that we're in right now. This was not a only God can judge me type of sermon. This was a live your life right because one day God is going to judge you. When I was growing up in my youth group, my pastor, he would always say, you know, a lot of people will tell you when you try to witness or talk to them about God that only God can judge them. And he said what you ought to say in response to that is he will, because God will judge you. It's not this far off concept that is like a really cool or ominous idea. It's going to happen. Every person who lives on this earth, who was born and has lived, will have a time to die and will also have a time to judgment. And I believe that this scripture that he referenced during his message was, I don't know where it is, but I will do my best to find the location for you. I might butcher it. It occurs to every man once to live and then judgment. So if you are living, one day you will meet Jesus and he will be your judge. So there are three different kinds of judgments: the judgment of the nations, the great white throne judgment, and the judgment seat of Christ. I'm mostly going to be focusing on the last two points for the purposes of this video. One point that he made under the judgment of the nations that I really like is that we are not all God's children. And I really like this because celebrity preachers will not tell you that. Celebrity preachers will say that God loves everybody, God is everybody's father, everyone's a child of God. And if you've been told that and you haven't accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then someone is lying to you. And I only come from a place of love. I don't come from a place of judgment, once again, because I'm not Jesus. But if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, then you are not a child of God. And if you're not a child of God, then you forfeit all the benefits and promises that come with being a child of God submitted to him. And I'm not saying that, it doesn't come from my mouth. It comes from John chapter 1 verse 12, which says, "But to all who have accepted him and believed in him, he has given the right to become children of God." Fun fact, when I was in middle school, I started a Bible club and that's what it was called. That's the verse it was based on. This is so stupid. I'm like so embarrassed about this. I don't know why, but it was called COG. You know how like when you're a cog in the machine and like you help things work together? That's what I named the club. COG, which stands for Children of God. And that was like the scripture verse. We are not all children of God. I was not a child of God before seventh grade when I accepted Jesus into my heart. I was not a child of God. I was a child of the devil because I was living in this world. And the Bible says that the devil is the prince of this world. So if you're in this world and you don't believe in Jesus, you don't live like you know Jesus, then God is not your father. And unfortunately, if you read it, you can read in the Bible, in the Gospels, when Jesus, I don't remember where this is, I have to find it, but he said to someone, "You are of your father, the devil." So either God is your father or the devil is your father. And you have the choice to pick who you're going to be under submission to. And let me tell you something, because I've been in both places, you do not want to be under the submission of the devil. The Bible says that before you today, I have set blessing and cursing, life and death. That's in Deuteronomy. Death looks a lot more pleasing when you're still alive. The things that will lead you to death look very, very enticing. And I don't remember what I was reading. I was reading this book right here. And it's by David Wilkerson. And it's called Victory Over Sin and Self. And it was talking about how people see themselves as hopelessly enslaved to sin, or they mask it by saying that they embrace that sin or they embrace that lifestyle. But when you are following the things of this world, you are a slave to sin. And that bondage, those chains get stronger every single day. I mean, this book is amazing. I'll see if it's on Amazon, link it in the description. It will change your life. I'm only on chapter 4. Obviously, it's very short. I'm only on chapter 4 and it is already changing my life. So that is a really good thing to remember, that if you are not under God's care, if you are not one of his sheep, it's actually funny because in this point, he also talked about the sheep versus the goats. God will separate the sheep from the goats in the judgment of the nations. And the sheep are the ones that know his voice, and the goats are the ones that, did not know his voice. You do not want to be on the wrong side of knowing God's voice. Look at this live stream. I'm going to link it in the description. Watch the live stream. And if you have not given your life to Christ, then you can message me on Instagram at Emily Oglo. Put my handle right here. Or you can comment down below and I will respond to you. Or if you want to chat, then I will chat with you as well. If you want to argue, then you really have to find someone else. Moving on, that's pretty much all I wanted to say for point one. That's a really common misconception. We are not all children of God. Okay, so point number two, something that he said under this point, like that basically sums up the whole thing that I really, really liked is that my pastor said, because I met Jesus at a cross, I won't have to meet him at a great white throne. So if you can't tell, the great white throne judgment is for those, the goats, that do not know God. And this will not be a good day. It really won't. But stay tuned because there's hope at the end of this. Jesus was our substitutionary atonement. Jesus took our place. I'm actually a substitute, obviously. Some of you guys know, some of you, this may be your first time here. I am a substitute at the daycare that I work at. So I fill in for people. I fill in for people when they're sick, when they're on vacation, when they're quarantining. I come in and I am sitting with their class and I work with the other teacher and I'm basically filling in their position. And Jesus did the same thing for you and for me on the cross. We were supposed to die a sinner's death. We are supposed to be in hell suffering the consequences of our sin. But no, Jesus died on a cross and he was our substitutionary atonement. His blood covered our sin. I have here in my notes that the blood is greater. His blood is greater than what you did last week. His blood is greater than your sin, than your shame, than your guilt. You don't have to live with that. So many times, I actually watch another preacher that I really love. His name is Jonathan Shuttlesworth. I'll have his podcast linked in the description. But he talks about a life of prosperity. And he does talk about finances and stuff, but not just that. He talks about having a life where you are not the victim, but the victor. Okay, and so I think a lot of times people, I don't get it. I understand it because I haven't always been a Christian. I haven't always been saved, I'll say that. People love throwing pity parties. People love the victim mentality. People love handouts. People love being treated special because they're handicapped. So people will hang on, and I've talked about this in another one of my videos, people will hang on to this notion of depression or anxiety or anything that will make them a victim, their skin color. I mean, come on. Like, I don't even want to get started on this. I really don't. But if you have the audacity, and people have said things to me like this, I've watched videos like this, because you're a minority, you can't do this. You can't even tell me I'm a minority. I am supposed to be, by the world standards, I am the lowest of the low. I am a female and I am black. I'm not just black, but my parents are immigrants. So that it makes me even lower on the scale of the word. But I'll tell you something, because Jesus took my sin on that cross, because he took all the issues and troubles and statuses that this world might place on me, all the things that could come from living in such a fallen world, Jesus took that on the cross so that I could be saved and go to heaven, and so that I could be a victor and not a victim. There is nothing I cannot do because of my skin color. And I refuse to listen to people who would tell me that this is how black people are supposed to act and this is what black people are supposed to believe. Not according to the word of God. My Bible's right there. That's why I'm pointing over there. But not according to the word of God. The Bible says that he is no respecter of persons. And the Bible also says that what man looks at, God doesn't look at. He doesn't look at our outward appearance. God doesn't see me and see black. God doesn't see me and see female. God doesn't see me. The Bible says that he will pour out his spirit on all flesh. Your sons, your daughters, old, young, alike. And it says that in the verse. He will pour out his spirit on all flesh. And last time I checked, this is flesh and blood. So don't allow yourself to become subject to all these notions and ideas that the world is going to throw at you and you don't even understand, like, oh, well, why am I supposed to be depressed? Why am I supposed to be oppressed? You don't have to be, because Jesus took it all on the cross with him. He took sickness, he took pain, he took your bondage, he took your chains, he took all of it on the cross so that you could live a holy and pure life, and you will not have to meet him at the great white throne judgment. Jesus took our sin and our pain and all of that so that we can meet him at point three, which is the judgment seat of Christ. So this is the final point that we talked about, and it is the one with the most hope. This is the judgment that believers will go to. This is the judgment that people of faith, people filled with the Holy Ghost who live according to the word of God, this is where they will go. Believers themselves, because of the sacrifice of Jesus, will not be judged for their sin. Believers, as they appear before Jesus, are completely washed clean. But the believer's works will be judged. So the Bible says that we are saved by grace alone and not by works. But our works do have meaning, purpose, and value to God. Let me tell you this, and if there's nothing else you take from this, if you're saved and you know God, God cares what you do. God has a purpose and calling for your life. You are not worthless. You should not be dilly-dallying and wasting your time. Talk to God about what he has for your life. Pray and fast and wait on him and know what he has called you to do, because at the end of your life, you will be called to account with what you used your time on, what you spent your money on, who you talked to, where you went, how closely you listen to the voice of God in regards to what he's calling you to do. Speaking of what he's calling you to do, one thing that my pastor said is don't play your life safe. Don't have a small vision because you don't serve a small God. You serve a big God, and so you should have a big vision. The same evangelist I was talking about earlier, I think there were three broadcasts that he uploaded on YouTube about how to make your wildest dreams come true. And it sounds like a cliche title, but when you are in Christ and he has called you to do something, God doesn't call you to something small. He calls you to something that he knows you'll have to rely on him for. Because oftentimes, if he calls us down the street to somewhere we're comfortable, then we can say, hey, I did this on my own. I did this in my own strength. And there comes pride. And God hates pride. But when God calls you to something big, then you have to rely on him for strength. And that is an amazing thing. And it's an amazing lesson to learn for life. I'm just going to close this off with the concept of eternity. Inventory your life and think, what am I doing today? Or tomorrow, or next week, or this month, what am I doing that has eternal value? And if you are thinking that and you don't have anything, you can't come up with anything that is eternally worth your time, then you gotta cut it out. One thing that my pastor said was to rearrange the priorities of your life and live with the goal of eternity in mind. My goal in life is not to get a degree. It's gonna be great when I do get my degree, but it's not my goal in life. My goal in life is not to do a bunch of things or accomplish a bunch of things for my own status and my own puffing up of my chest. No, that is not my goal in life. My goal in life is to please God and to put things of eternal value, store up my treasures in heaven. And one thing of my pastor, he always says this, if you listen to him talk for 20 minutes, he cannot go 20 minutes without talking about souls. Because souls are the only thing that matters. Souls are eternal. We come into this earth with nothing and we leave with nothing. But you come into this earth with a soul and the soul goes out as well. So souls are eternal and souls are what matter to God. So save souls, bring people to the knowledge of Christ, and let Jesus transform your priorities to things that are eternally worth your time. I don't know about you guys, but I love these videos. I love vlog plus sit down all in one. It's like so... Thank you guys so much for watching this Come to Church with me. It's always such a joy to share the word of God and also kind of share my little morning routine and my Sunday, because Sundays are always so peaceful. For the most part. This Sunday was a little hectic, I'm not gonna lie. I love you guys so much, but God loves you more, and I will see you in the next video. Mwah! Don't forget to like and subscribe, by the way. Just like the button, and the red, yeah, just do that. Bye!